Hello, and thank you for tuning in to my talk today. I'm going to be talking about redefining embedded learning with ESP and Rust. So I'm going to start with a little bit about myself, followed with embedded learning and where I see probably a significant gap nowadays in the learning process of embedded systems and even combined with Rust. Then looking at potentials of closing the gaps and what the ESP ecosystem actually provides us in order to achieve that. So a little bit about myself. I'm currently in academia and computer engineering in particular. However, I come also from an industry background, particularly in automotive embedded systems. I've been focusing on Rust for a little bit over 2 years now, in which I focused particularly on embedded Rust education. And during that phase, I founded the Embedded Rustation newsletter and also blog. I'm also the author of two books, which are Wire World and Simplified Embedded Rust. So a little bit about Simplified Embedded Rust. This is a book of two editions that is actually based on the ESP32C3 device and combined with the Rust programming language. And it was mainly a reflection of what I encounter in teaching embedded systems and what I encountered in learning embedded systems with Rust. So I'll touch more on this later, as a lot of this talk relates to what my thoughts were about creating that book. So starting with embedded learning. We as educators, ideally, students that come into a certain field to learn, they would have some level of curiosity about this field. And our duty is to nurture this curiosity to help them find their passion. So along the lines of, well, embedded Rust, given that it's also an open source project, if the passion that these learners find or the learners find would be in embedded Rust, it would help towards increasing adoption and help the project grow. So in a way, also maybe finding their passion quicker is another way to put it, given that if they do not really reflect on a certain field, then we don't have to keep them there for long. So when we look at curiosity in terms of learning, it's often split into four stages. So the first two stages have more to do with procedural knowledge, where students rely more on lecture or teacher to help them through these phases. And the latter two have more to do with self-knowledge, in the sense that students become more independent, relying on their own capabilities to get through the remainder of the process. So starting with each one of these, at the process phase, typically what this entails is providing students with the different tools and frameworks or that they would need for learning. And well, in a way, it's a phase that helps orient them into what is required to learn the content that is coming up. So in the second stage, that's where the actual content is delivered. And this is where the, let's say, teacher or lecturer's duty is to provide quality content to help them learn the material properly and quickly. In a transfer stage, that's where students start relying more on their own capabilities or the knowledge that they acquired to potentially solve questions or do mini projects. And then finally, in the self phase, this is where we would expect that students reflect more on the material that they learned and potentially discovered whether this is their passion or not. This is the phase that ultimately we'd like to get students to as fast as possible. So in my own experience, I would say that there's mainly two categories or types of learners along those stages. So on the right side, there's the type of student that is already probably in the field and has already reflected on a certain material or a certain field, and they just want to acquire new knowledge in a in similar field. So they would be there to sort of go through those stages and acquire the associated knowledge with the additional part that they want to add to their knowledge within an existing field. However, the second type is typically the type that is curious but doesn't know much about a certain field. So this is the type of student that, as an educator, probably we would have to invest more time into keeping them excited so we can get them to a stage where they can actually find their passion or see if the topic itself is their passion. So if we look at these stages along with excitement levels with time, so an ideal case would be something like this, where excitement keeps on growing with time until students find their passion, and this is sort of the highest level of excitement. However, this is typically not a linear line. It has its ups and downs, but the idea is that the trend is a growing one. Now, if we look at a traditional embedded learning process, typically in the early stages, we ask students of things like this, where they would need to choose and acquire hardware. They would have to wire this hardware, set up some tool chains, IDE choices, even frameworks for that matter. Only then, when we transfer to a content stage, that we start transferring knowledge and doing some coding. So students might have seen some of that early on, but it wouldn't have been something that they can do much with given the level of knowledge that they acquired at that point, which is not much. So maybe they would run a Blinky example to make sure that their hardware is working, or experiment with other small snippets, but nothing more than that. And then in a transfer stage, that's when students will start exercising with examples on their own or solving problems, maybe even mini projects and labs. And finally, in a self stage, this is when they actually potentially do their own projects within a group or on their own. So what I often encounter with this type of approach is something like this. And I think many of us that are in the embedded world can relate to this in terms of what potential frustrations you can run into in doing all of these initial setups, or even choosing the framework or even hardware that you want to deal with. And the thing about it is, what is sort of an issue here for somebody that is new to the field is that they might run into issues without having enough knowledge to be able to fix those issues. So frustration builds up fairly quickly. And this is the impression that they build up about embedded when it's not necessarily the case. Because for the most part, if you manage to set up a proper framework for yourself, you can use it for a while without having to change much. So if we compare this to learning programming languages nowadays, and from a learning curve perspective, learning programming languages, you can become really proficient fairly quickly, given that nowadays, probably the first stage of process, all you need to do is open up a web page and you can start coding. You can go into a content stage almost immediately. However, as we've just seen, this is not necessarily always the case with embedded systems. And this is what I like to refer to as the embedded gap, in the sense that it takes longer to become proficient because of a lot of that work that has to be there ahead of time. So how do we close this gap? If we take a closer look, again, the challenges had to do mostly with hardware and software setup. So talking about hardware accessibility, whether it's in acquiring, choosing a particular hardware, the cost of the hardware, and then setting it up and wiring it, and which also implies knowledge about electronics. And then you have the part on the software end, which has to do with tool chains and software setup. And then we have, well, the ecosystem options and frameworks that students have to choose from. If we add on top of that the Rust challenge, so Rust itself as a language is often stereotyped as a language that is tough to learn. And most newcomers to embedded Rust would be more familiar with out-of-the-box Rust, which what I mean by that is the Rust based on the standard library, which has much more features and abstractions that one can utilize and doesn't necessarily require much low-level knowledge. And then additionally, Rust is an open source project and much of the content in the field is frequent to change. So students would have to keep up with that as well. So in order to address the challenges, maybe one framework that already exists is the Arduino model, which makes hardware more accessible to use and provides a full solution of a hardware slash software combination. However, I would say that even with that, there are issues that have to do sometimes with accessibility or even hardware itself having issues, whether it's with drivers and so on, that students sometimes even run into. There is the part about the options, and this is more of an educator effort that would have to limit these options in terms of frameworks and ecosystem. But finally, my line of thought is more with shifting a lot of these things to a later stage of learning. But well, the question is how. So if we look at the tasks that we talked about that are typically an issue, whether it's acquiring hardware, wiring hardware, tool chains, and IDE, the point is to take them towards a later stage. And the idea behind this is that, well, if we do this, what I had expressed earlier is that students typically have a higher level of excitement toward a later stage. And, well, probably at that point, they would have found their passion. So these type of things, other than having the knowledge to be able to push through them, it wouldn't be something that would frustrate a learner quickly that would cause them to give up on the topic. So we can provide more focus on learning embedded or coding embedded without having to deal with any of these challenges. And then when the student becomes more comfortable and more excited for that matter, we can introduce these things. Now, the question of how, there's probably two approaches, but the idea is that we provide alternatives for hardware and also pre-configured setups to students that they could just pick and start coding immediately, replicating the software experience or the programming language experience that I was expressing earlier. So there's two main approaches that probably exist in terms of solutions nowadays. So one of them is remote real hardware, and this is probably inspired by professional environments for debug, where you would have a pre-configured setup along with a camera, and you would connect remotely to this setup from home using an IDE, and you can tinker with that hardware remotely without having to change anything. You just have to connect to it. Another approach is simulators. So simulators in the context of CPU simulators probably have existed for a while, but here what I mean by simulators is more of a system simulator that includes a development board along with components that you can simulate or interact with. And within that context, to the extent of my knowledge, there's two solutions there, which are WAQI and Tinkercad. So in terms of the ESP ecosystem, there's actually a unique combination that is available right now for beginners to use, which is WAQI with ESP devices or boards and Rust. So Espressif, within their ecosystem, they provide official support for Rust on ESP devices and also for Rust on WAQI. So you can actually spawn a simulation with several options of ESP devices. You can hook up components and you can start coding right away. Another part that is quite interesting from the ESP offering perspective is that it offers support both for the core library and the standard library. So earlier, as we expressed the Rust challenges, we said that most are familiar with out-of-the-box Rust, which is based on the standard library. So this option makes it more comfortable for those that are familiar with Rust, but not necessarily embedded systems and want to get into the space. So this is what the WAQI webpage looks like. So you just have to open one and start coding. Now, this one doesn't have any components wired externally. So that would still be part where an educator would have to provide these pre-wired solutions. But again, there's still a lot that you can do even with the bare board itself without having to wire anything, especially functions that have to do with IoT. But again, the idea is that, well, all you had to do is spawn a web page and start coding, replicating programming language learning experience. So, there is more that WAQI offers. So it's not just a simulation environment. So if at a certain point you decide to connect hardware, you can flash immediately from a browser. You can actually even do local development if you want to. So with VS Code and JetBrains, there is support for WAQI where you can actually do the simulation from a your own IDE, or sorry, your own text editor. There are options for profiling. And what is also very interesting, there is IoT support. And by that, what I mean is that from the simulator, you can actually simulate the connection to Wi-Fi and interact with the internet or the cloud, doing HTTP requests and so on. So there is much more, which for those interested can discover on the WAQI website. So in conclusion, I think that there's a lot that is available right now from an embedded education perspective that different projects can benefit from in order to transform the embedded learning approach. And what is exciting right now is that along with languages like Rust that are open source, there is a lot of natural excitement around it that hopefully more, let's say, platforms can join a similar effort in providing such solutions for an educational perspective. And the idea is that, well, again, for any open source project, having a lot of contributors is obviously a huge benefit. And in order to increase adoption for a certain field, we need to remove the impediments for learning to help learners or people that are curious, if you will, get there quicker in hope that this would be their passion and finally contribute to the project. So just real quick, back to the book. As I mentioned, I'm going to touch back on it. So this is mainly what I had in mind when creating the both editions of this book. So it is a book that is self-contained in the sense that you can learn and do everything within the solutions or examples that are associated with the book, along with pre-wired examples with WAQI. So even for questions or exercises in the book, they are also pre-wired. So it helps streamline that process without having to spend much time, or any time for that matter, trying to figure out these things in order to start coding embedded software. So with Rust in particular. Additionally, because of the regular changes within the ecosystem, given that it's still dynamic in nature, there is or isn't a lot of stability just yet. So these books are regularly updated such that it keeps up with what is available right now in the ecosystem. So that's what I had for today. Thank you for watching. And if there's any questions, please let me know.